All right, everybody, this is Ross Raddi, and welcome to another episode of Fruit Talk. This is the podcast style video that I do for you guys. Every Wednesday night at 9 o'clock Eastern, we talk a lot about fruits, a lot about vegetables, how to use some of that stuff in the kitchen, and also how to grow it. And usually the weird and interesting things that maybe you've never heard of. In this episode of Fruit Talk, we're going to be talking about the honeyberry, also known as hascap. It has a couple names for it. It's a berry that really resembles a blueberry, but it has a different shape. And I want to talk about my thoughts on it thus far after this season and finally really getting a nice handle on the flavor and what I really think about the berry. And then we're going to be talking about our garden. Our fall garden is kind of in the works right now. And I would suggest, especially for a lot of you guys out there that maybe have a shorter season or not much time left of the year, it's time to be thinking about a fall garden. In fact, I probably could have and should have planted a number of different things a bit earlier than even what I'm going to do in this next week. So big recommendation around the beginning of July, even mid-June to early June, certain crops need to be planted at that time to ensure that you have a decent fall crop. So we're going to be laying out a little bit about the garden, some things that I've picked up this year that I thought were very interesting, that is definitely going to change my way of gardening forever in a smaller space. I figured out a nice way to grow more food in a smaller space. And those kind of things that you pick up are really, really awesome, really beneficial. We're also going to be mentioning some things that have really helped out my garden this year. In particular, something called silica. So stay tuned for that. Hopefully you guys get to the end. Let's start off with the honeyberry here. And I've been growing honeyberries, I think, now for close to 4 years. I think this is my fourth or maybe even fifth season with honeyberries. I guess I could find out for sure in my email. I could probably go back and see when was the first honeyberry I've ever ordered. But I do remember getting some originally from Stark Brothers. I know I got some from Honeyberry USA. And then since I've even gotten some, I think, from Honeyberry USA again last season, because my thought process on the honeyberry was that they're just not sweet enough. And a berry should be sweet, most of them, if you're going to eat them fresh anyway. Otherwise, they have to have a really interesting flavor to make them something worthwhile in processing. And I can wholeheartedly say, after I have grown them now this year, this is again my fourth or fifth season with them, that I finally got a real understanding of the berry, I think. It's really quite sad because I have to say it really does take a while, and I think this video is really going to save some of you guys some time. If you're growing this particular fruit, I think knowing what I'm about to tell you guys now really would have made a big difference when I first started out growing this particular fruit, which is very simply that the berry needs to be blue for a very long time. I mean, a very long time. So let's talk about really quickly, though, what is a honeyberry? A honeyberry is a kind of in the honeysuckle family, and they're edible. I think other honeysuckles are also edible, different parts of the plant, but I think it's a plant that is native to cooler climates for sure. And I know that places like or people in Japan and in Canada particularly have really put a lot of time and have devoted a lot of resources to developing and breeding this particular fruit. It does indeed look a lot like a blueberry. of a different shape. In fact, I even did a video today, tonight I did it, before it got totally dark outside. And I compared, because I have honeyberries right next to my blueberries, I compared blueberries directly, side by side, to honeyberries. And I have to tell you, they visually look very similar, obviously different shape, but I think they also taste very similar. So I think it's weird that they look the same and they even feel the same in your mouth. The whole thing's kind of strange, really, how something that's of a very different species could be so similar to another species. I think that's just a little bit mind-blowing to me. You would have thought, I guess, that they look similar. It would be like the total opposite, that they wouldn't really be all that similar in terms of the flavor. But it's true. I think they really are quite similar plants. So that's kind of the background, I guess, is that they're very popular in Japan. I know a lot of the varieties are coming from Japan. A lot of the varieties are being bred also by the University of Sasquatch. I don't know how to say the name of that university. Let's see here. Saskatchewan. University of Saskatoon. Saskatchewan. I don't know, guys. Okay. I'm not Canadian, and I don't know about anything. But anyway, so I think because they are getting a lot of attention, it really has sparked a lot of interest in other growers, especially hobbyists, even people who are trying to make this into like a new crop, a new commercial crop, really putting a lot of time into all this. And the people at honeyberryusa.com have really dedicated a lot of time and information towards this fruit. And they sell a lot of these berries at their nursery. And yeah, it's just quite interesting how this has sort of taken off. And I think because there is a lot of varied information out there, and also it takes a very long time for these plants to mature. And it also takes a very long time for these plants to really understand as the grower when to pick these particular fruits. It just creates a lot of sort of animosity, I guess, about the fruit, and a lot of misinformation as well. I'm even subject to that, I guess, as well, because while I really didn't claim to know really much about the fruit, I was sort of putting my thoughts out there at that current moment of the prior years of when I had been growing them and had been tasting them. But I'll tell you, I mean, at least at this point, I do genuinely believe that I've got a really strong, firm handle on this particular fruit. So what I'm trying to get at here, and what I was kind of making my point before, is that the fruit is really the first fruit of the yard, of any of the fruits I grow, to turn color. So a lot of people make this claim that the honeyberry is the earliest fruit to ripen. And that is just not true. It's very, very far from the truth. And we even talked about this two episodes ago of Fruit Talk, where I talked about the honeyberry being one of the earliest fruits. When in reality, I think actually this is really the time around the summer solstice that you would actually see the majority of the fruits ripe in my yard. And maybe that'll depend on the variety, but I'll tell you, it really took them an entire month. So around the 22nd, today's the 22nd of June at the time of filming, at the 22nd of May, the berries had turned blue, or at least got a bluish tint to them. And the fact that they've turned color first, the birds really go after them. The birds really love them. And it's kind of, you know, it's really a struggle, because you're kind of caught off guard. First off, the birds obviously beat you to it. You don't even realize that they're blue just yet. and the birds kind of already are ahead of you, and they're getting at these things. And if you wait too long to put the nets on, you're going to regret it. You're going to lose most of your fruits. So for me, I've done that for years. I've lost most of my fruits, although not many have ever really been produced off of these bushes. I did lose most of my fruits for years. And I'll tell you, if you don't get the nets, you got to get the nets on, number one. Number two, after you get the nets on and everything kind of calms down, nothing's really getting at these berries, you really have to wait a month. And at the minimum, I would say 3 weeks. I could even say 5 to 6 weeks potentially. Maybe 6 weeks is too much, but I would say somewhere in that 3 to 5 week mark, they're going to actually be ripe. And that puts us pretty much at today. In fact, today I was picking some that I could have even waited longer on. So it just goes to show that for a long time, a lot of people pick them when they turn blue and they think, oh, they must be ripe, they're blue. That's not the case. People also have been saying on different places that you can find information on these things, they've been saying that the honeyberry needs to be picked 2 weeks after it turns blue. And I just think that's just not enough time. The honeyberry will be ripe when you can pick it very easily off the plant. You don't have to struggle in any form. In fact, you may want to start seeing them fall on the ground. And what's sort of deceptive about these berries is that they can fall on the ground for a number of reasons, I think. If they're young, they might just fall off prematurely, or they may still not really even be ripe, even though they fell off the plant. So my best guess is really you'll see the berry turn very plump. It'll really get some size to it. It'll seem quite soft, and it comes right off of the bush very easily with almost no force being put into that at all. So knowing that and observing that this year, I've been able to actually, I was just very patient. I wasn't very eager to pick the fruits. I really wasn't even thinking about the fruits because I was so busy with other things and I had a lot of fruits. I mean, like 70% of my diet nowadays has been fruit. And I've been eating a lot of strawberries. Those are now done. The red currants, the gumi, the blueberries are coming in. The raspberries are coming in. You should see me out there. I'm basically a bird grazing on all the fruits in the backyard. And it's wonderful. It really is wonderful. I feel great, I have to say. I feel very good, believe it or not, even eating mostly carbs and mostly fruit. I feel fantastic. We can get into that a whole nother time, but I really feel better. Not necessarily, I think, because I'm eating food straight out of my garden or my orchard, but mostly because I think I've been eating less meat, and a lot of the foods I've been eating, mostly fruits and vegetables or carbs, is just a lot easier to digest. And I think that has been making me feel better overall, because you really do have to struggle. Your body has to work harder to digest protein. Not that I'm turning into a vegetarian, but you know, it could be something I may try in the future. And I did try it for a couple of days just to see if anything was going to happen immediately. But anyway, the point is that I didn't really notice, and I wasn't really eager to pick the honeyberry this year to really find out the scoop on them. And then therefore, I was patient enough, in a sense, and was able to get the berries when they were actually ripe. So my understanding here as well is that not only did I learn how to pick them when they are perfectly ripe, but I also learned that they're very good. It is a very good fruit. The hype is real. They do deserve a lot of attention. Just like gumi is one of my favorite fruits now, the honeyberry is one of my favorite fruits now, for sure. And what you'll end up getting out of the flavor when it is perfectly ripe is something similar to a blueberry. I mean, it really does have a blueberry-like flavor. I find that they have more of a wild taste to them. And what I mean by wild is that they sort of are like an alpine strawberry versus a strawberry, or maybe kind of have like a currant-y flavor to them. How currants are really out there in terms of their flavor. Let me think about some other way of explaining this. Maybe some other berry. They just have a more wild and interesting, very like a tart mixed berry flavor. It's not really necessarily one berry in particular. I do pick up blueberry. I pick up kiwi. I pick up grape as well. And it kind of you combine those three fruits together, and that's what you get. And I guess in a sense, I was right about that in prior years, but I didn't really understand that they were actually quite similar to blueberries at the time. They also have a very similar texture and mouthfeel to a blueberry. There is blueberries that I grow that are a bit wild. I have a low bush that's a ground cover blueberry. That's a bit wild in flavor. And then I also have a Chippewa blueberry. And if I look this up, I'm kind of curious because I've been saying that, it's a wild blueberry, but yeah, it says here it's a half high blueberry. Let's see here what else they have to say. Yeah, nothing here about this wild flavor. But I do remember reading this somewhere. Maybe I read it on Edible Landscaping. Maybe Edible Landscaping has this variety. Chippewa. No, not exactly here. Now, because it's a half high instead of a high bush blueberry, there was some debate, I guess, as to whether or not it was going to be able to be pollinated properly, if it would also do well here in terms of maybe the amount of chill hours. Let's see on One Green World here what they had to say about the chill hours. Doesn't say. Where did I even get my Chippewa blueberry here? Let's see here. I go to my spreadsheet. Chippewa I got from Burnt Ridge. So let's go to Burnt Ridge and see their Chippewa. Nothing. Interesting. So strange how I can't find anything on this thing anymore. What happened? Why is the internet doing this to me? I wonder if it's a southern type, if they have it listed as a southern or a northern. Unreal, dude. It's not even listed here on this website. All right, the point is, okay, maybe I'm making this up, but I do taste it within the berry for sure, and that it does have a more wild blueberry flavor. It is a half high, as I said. I don't know the chill hours. It is getting pollinated reasonably well. I wouldn't say the pollination's perfect, but it is just as good, I think, or pretty close to other varieties of blueberries I have. And because it's a wild blueberry flavor, it has a ne it's just another level on the blueberry scale for me. It is my favorite tasting of the blueberries I grow. It maybe not isn't the small isn't the biggest blueberry, but it has the best flavor. And therefore I like that wildness in it. That's really what does it for me. And the honeyberry is just a very similar fruit to that wild Chippewa blueberry. So I find it really interesting. That I guess what I'm trying to say is that take a blueberry, and if you have the best blueberry you have, which is Chippewa, at least for me, I think maybe even the honeyberry might be slightly better than Chippewa. Maybe it's on par with that, but I would say, at least for now, it's at least on par with blueberries. And if you like blueberries, and if you appreciate blueberries, and you think they have a spot in your garden or your orchard, I think it's worth growing a honeyberry. I do. And what the nice thing about them is, they do taste really good fresh, if you can get them fresh. Perfectly ripe, that is. If you can wait, you can be patient. Ideally, you should wait regardless, even if you're going to process them. But if you do process them, you can use them any way you use a blueberry. In fact, you're going to get a different take on your standard blueberry flavor. So you're going to have maybe even, you could have a better blueberry jam. You could have a better blueberry pancake. You could have a better blueberry pie. I don't know. It could be worse too. I really don't know. I know for a fact they make really great processed products. So for me, I'm sold on it. It's at least worth trying to continue with it, and I put my stamp of approval on it. I highly recommend them. I would say they're probably like an 8 out of 10 on the scale of fruit that I grow. Of all the fruits, it's probably like an 8 out of 10. Now, some other real tips about these honeyberry plants is, for the plant themselves, they take a while to mature. I wouldn't move them. Plant them where you're going to put them and keep them there. Probably wouldn't move them. You're going to get some good transplant shock. It's not going to be the end of the world, but you know, these berries, a lot of these low growing plants, like even the ribes, like the gooseberry and the currants, the honeyberry, they sort of remind me of a similar plant in that they are just kind of difficult to get them established. Maybe not so much the currants, but definitely I think the gooseberries. You know what? I would actually argue that the honeyberry is more difficult to establish than the ribes. So you need to really be patient, and you can speed this up, of course, again, by not transplanting them. Planting them when they're smaller is going to be a big help. Don't plant bigger plants if you can help it. Preferably plants that are not too root bound either. I would also recommend probably not bare rooted plants. I would probably rather have potted plants, small potted plants. And you really gotta put on the organic material every year. Put something down. If you're not gonna put down organic material, or compost, I should say, or worm castings, put down some mulch. Keep the mulch and definitely insulate the soil well. They like moisture. They like cooler soil temperatures, I believe. And if you can use that mulch, it really fulfills both of those requirements. You end up getting a much better honeyberry, and it becomes mature a lot quicker. So that's a big, big recommendation. I would even recommend probably getting rid of the fruit in the first couple years. I don't think it would make a big difference, but it's not really necessary. I would rather be patient at this point. I would think about any way I can get my honeyberry to get established quicker, and that's what I would do. I think they just struggle a bit, and I know in the summer they really just stop growing. They put on a lot of growth in the spring, and they kind of stay stagnant for the rest of the season. So maybe in a colder place, a place with a colder summer, they'll continue to grow. But it seems like that's what their life cycle is. They grow in the beginning of the spring, and then they put out their fruits. And because their fruits are forming and they're ripening their fruits, maybe that is then hindering the growth into the summer. So if I can maybe take off the fruits at an earlier age, I think it might be a big benefit. Also, I believe they do resume some growth after the summer when things cool down a bit. Could be wrong on that, but if we can really just get them more established quicker, I think we'll all be a lot happier. And yeah, those are my big honeyberry tips. I think that's really all I have to say on the plant, at least for now. And oh, I would also try to get some sweeter varieties, although not that necessary. If you can get them perfectly ripe, it doesn't seem to really be all that necessary. Now, I do want to talk about the garden here. First off, the garden has been doing incredibly well. A big part of that is a product I've been using called Dynagrow Protect, and I have been preaching about this stuff for quite some time without really even knowing how great the benefit would be of this particular product. I did know that there is a big benefit of silica. A lot of us don't have silica in our soils. It's been pretty well documented and researched at this point. A lot of professors at different universities have spoken on silica and how important it is and how it really isn't just present anymore. But if you look at the Earth's crust and you look at the percentage of silica in the Earth's crust, it's like quite a bit. However, it's just not present in a lot of our gardens and a lot of our farms. And I'll tell you, it makes a huge difference in terms of the plant's internal pest resistance, the plant's internal disease resistance. They also say that it helps with heat and cold shock. So it also helps with drought tolerance is what people say. I think personally, I've seen it firsthand, is the pest pressure is just dramatically decreased. Flea beetles across the board don't seem to really go after these plants nearly as much because of the silica. So it is just like a dramatic change, dramatic. So you should see my plants, you know, before I sprayed this stuff and after I sprayed this stuff. It's wonderful, and it's across the board on the nightshades, the eggplants, the ground cherries, the peppers, the tomatoes, the melons. You know, across the board, these things are getting big benefits out of this stuff, and I really should be spraying, I think, a bit more of my crops rather than just those crops I mentioned. I think it's really a big benefit to do a foliar spray as well. I actually am a big fan of doing a foliar spray. It's a lot less work. It really doesn't take all that much time. You know, you can really get a lot of this stuff on the plants real quickly and give them some nice feed, and it doesn't necessarily affect the soil all that much. You know, because you're doing a foliar spray rather than something at the soil level. And I'd rather, if I can help it, keep a lot of my synthetic fertilizers out of the garden, out from the soil, and instead only use organic materials in the soil. And I may actually try that next year. I may, not necessarily on the garden, because that's actually how I do it, is I don't use any synthetic fertilizers in the garden or in the ground. But in the pots, I may try some organic fertilizer next year instead, and then only do a foliar sprays to help improve the soil in those pots. I think that might be a really good idea that I'm going to do next year. So the silica is a big thing for me. Now, the fall garden's coming in, and a lot of us, I think, hopefully are preparing for this kind of thing, and that's really what any garden needs, is good preparation, good planning. And this is my sheet here that I have on my spreadsheet that I use to plan my garden and how everything's kind of worked out, and things sort of changed a little bit. I actually ended up having a lot more tomatoes than I had originally thought, which is good. And I was able to actually go into the paths, as you can see here, that I'm highlighting on YouTube. Our Yacone never came up, and some things never really worked out. The cool loving crop beds, actually two more of them were created around here and here. And therefore I just have a lot more room to grow that isn't really necessarily in the spreadsheet just yet. But everything else in here really came in exactly as I planned, which is great. I think some of the Brussels sprouts and broccoli didn't get the best start, but you know, it is what it is. So what we're gonna do is sort of plan for a garden now, because I actually have peas that are coming out of the ground, and they're at the end of their life cycle, and we have a number of different things in these cool living crop beds that will come out at some point as well, like our onions. We have constantly a harvest of turnips and radishes. We have Mizuna coming in right now. Our arugula has been way over at this point. It's been done for quite some time. The Brussels sprouts are kind of doing their thing now, which is nice. Some of the broccoli is finally doing its thing now, which is nice. But, you know, certain things can obviously be moved around and changed up, and we don't necessarily have to have a continuation of what we already have. We can always keep planting new things and take things out and put new things in. As long as we keep adding a little bit of compost every year, maybe we have to add a little bit of fertilizer here and there, a little bit of micronutrients, we can keep getting multiple crops out of our garden beds. The no-dig approach is really something that I look to with my garden beds, and that's really just simply putting down compost every year. Very little tillage, if any, and putting down compost every year. And that has always worked well for me, and the results, I think, are pretty clear across the board. Yeah, that's a big thing here, is that we're going to put in some things. What I'm planning to do is put in some broccoli for the fall. I have a specific broccoli that's meant for fall. You can probably even get some cabbages. I may try cabbage that's meant for fall. I may try, maybe even I could do some Brussels sprouts now, but probably I won't. I would like to do the Kyoto red carrot that Baker Creek sells. That's a carrot that's meant to be harvested after a couple frosts, or even in the spring or in the winter time, and it overwinters in the ground, and that's the way it gets very sweet. So we'll probably do something like that. I'd also like to do some beets, assuming you know, things are not too warm. The unfortunate part about doing beets and Swiss chard at this point is that it's difficult to get them to germinate. So I may get them germinated inside, transplant them outside. Who knows? But I'll tell you, the sky's the limit right now, is that we can really do almost anything, except that something that needs a longer season that I probably should have planted in June. Things like my leeks and the Brussels sprouts, maybe even the cabbages, are not necessarily the best idea right now. They just need too much time, and you know, planting them now is kind of is a little difficult, in the sense that you need to have the plants ready. You need to keep them protected from bugs and insects. If you're doing any kind of fall garden and you're planting this stuff out in the summer, you have to plant this stuff under insect netting. If you don't, you're really going to regret it. I don't care how much silica you use. It's going to be very challenging. If you can keep them cooler as well, I would strongly suggest that. Maybe even putting down some mulch to cool the soil down would be a big recommendation. Watering them a bit more often would also be a big recommendation. Yeah, so that's sort of what we're planning, at least in terms of the fall garden. It's not really set in stone. I think, you know, this is really, this part of the talk was really to kind of highlight that this is what we should be doing. This is how to do it. These are some of the crops that we can do. The planning I should do probably on my own at a separate time. However, I do want to talk about some planning with you guys right now, because to end this talk of fruit talk here, I would like to mention something we've learned, which really revolves around the alliums. Okay, first off, I mentioned leeks. We don't ever need leeks. We can grow elephant garlic that doubles as garlic and a leek, number one. Number two, big fan of onions, and I think we should put onions, instead of doing them in the spring, planting them out in the spring, we should be planting some onions in the fall to then harvest in the spring, and around the same time as the garlic. So that's sort of also what I love, is garlic. So I love my alliums. I love the garlic. I love the onions. Definitely should do the elephant garlic, which again acts as a leek and garlic, a mild form of garlic. And then also you can do shallots. And the shallot really is the best allium for cooking. It really should be in a place of most onions. However, I find they're a little bit more difficult to grow, something that I don't really, I'm not, I haven't been too fond of them just yet. And I've been also struggling to kind of figure them out. I like the idea of garlic, and elephant garlic, in that you plant a bulb or you plant a clove, and the bigger the clove, the bigger the bulb, the bigger the bulb will be in the next season, in the spring when you harvest. So shallots, I find, really come in varying sizes when you order these things, and I haven't really been able to also get the planting time down. I think what I definitely need to do, and I know this varies depending on where you live, but I would rather have the shallots and the elephant garlic leaf out to some degree before the winter time, before the winter comes. Because what I've been struggling with here with the shallots, which is different than the garlic and the elephant garlic that I've grown in the past, is that the garlic leaves out and has leaves all winter time, where the shallots and the elephant garlic do not, at least for me. And that's what I was told is correct. And I think people really worry about, how cold those plants can get. And I don't think there really is a great need to really worry about them. I know maybe you could make an argument for somebody that's further north of me, but I think I should be fine here. I think I should. And also, we can mulch them with some straw and really keep them warm during the wintertime. So I'm really not worried about that at all. And I think that makes a big difference with your crop the following season. If you can get them to leaf out, and maybe that is what you're supposed to do. I don't know. Maybe I was told some wrong information. I've talked to different people on this, and I know in the South, you definitely want to have those things leaf out before the winter comes. That's a big deal. And maybe shallots are just not something that really I should be growing here. Maybe there's other things that do just better. I don't know, but I'm kind of on the fence with the shallots, but the other three, really, I'm on board with. And I'd rather, I think, grow most of my onions in the fall than actually in the spring. The spring onions do last the longest in storage. So that's nice. That's a big benefit. But it just seems like to me it's a lot easier and a lot better to get your onions in the fall and then harvest them in the spring. You have, it's a joke at how easy it is. So we're going to do that. We're definitely going to do that. And I'm going to still try to work on perfecting my spring onions, to then harvest sometime in the summer. My spring planted onions, I should say, to then be harvested in the summer. Here's what I've learned, though, across the board with these alliums, is that the ones you plant in the fall, you inevitably will harvest sometime in June. Even as early as June 1st. Maybe you could even do some in early May. I'm not entirely sure. But what that means to me here in this climate, my location, is that that's a month after our last frost. So if May 1st, our last frost, we harvest around June 1st. Finally, around June 1st, that's really when we're technically in the summer and the soil has really warmed up. It takes quite some time. I have played around with May 15th for years, and that's a great date if you want to be very early with this stuff. But I'll tell you, June 1st is just as good. And maybe in some situations it could be better. Like corn, probably better to do it on June 1st than May 15th. However, it does depend on the year. And what this means to me is that if the garlic and the alliums and elephant garlic and the onions are being harvested around June 1st, that leaves me an open spot to be able to plant something right after it. that loves the heat. So that's where this saving space thing comes in really well, and I'm able to, of course, get these things in the ground in succession in a really better way. So as an example, this raised bed here, which is dedicated entirely to my heat-loving crops, I could very easily have this entire thing filled with alliums in the fall, and then I could plant in right after them some heat-loving crops that would start again around June 1st. Obviously, this is going to have to be played around with, and I'm probably going to have to leave some gaps in between different things because let's say I don't harvest on June 1st. I would like to get my crops in at least by May 15th or June 1st the latest, so I can plant them in between the rows of, let's say, onions, or in between the rows of, let's say, garlic. And as soon as that garlic and things come out, they're already there. They've already acclimated themselves. They've already transitioned well and dug themselves in, and they're ready to go for the summer. So I think that makes a whole lot of sense in terms of saving space. I did it this year without even, well, it really did occur to me this year. So what I did was, where all this garlic and shallots were, I planted this entire thing right after I harvested with cucumbers. So now I have cucumbers coming up, and they'll be able to be harvested probably a month or so, month and a half from now at the latest. And I'm looking really good in terms of the amount of space that I'm making use of with what I have, you know, my limited space that I have. So that's a big one for me, is doing it like that. You could even have and make an argument in here, I could do the same thing, is harvest a lot of, you know, the alliums, and then put in the corn, put in the melons right after that. And it would just make a whole lot more sense for, you know, for making use of my space. So that's kind of the video here, guys. I'm really looking forward to that, making use of that space next year, and we'll see how it all works out. You know, instead of having, you know, four rows of corn planted May 15th, I could have, you know, eight rows of alliums. In between the rows, you put in the corn around May 15th or even June 1st, and you're still looking pretty. You're still looking good. There isn't necessarily, it's not really a big deal. Although next year I would really like to see myself at the community garden, so we'll see how that all works out. But with the coronavirus and all that, and how everything kind of is in the world, how it's all working, pretty much, you know, 9 months from now. But yeah, this is it's quite inspiring, I think, to learn something like this. I wish I had more ideas like this. I know for sure that you can do this with a bunch of different crops now. You know, things like my peas, as an example. The peas come out, other things go in. You know, so at the end of June, around that summer solstice date, as soon as the peas end, you put in another crop. And it just makes a whole lot of sense like this, to do it this way. So yeah, I want to thank everybody out here for watching this episode of Fruit Talk, getting to the end for me. I do appreciate it. Please check out the blog, figboss.com. We have all kinds of fig related information there. We'd love to talk about figs. And also on FigBid, I have three trees for sale, and that is in the description of the video, the link to the trees that we have for sale. And what's really weird about the three trees I have for sale, it's kind of really quite unusual. They are some of my most favorite varieties in this climate. And I'll tell you why exactly here. Trying to find it. But I have a photo. Actually, here it is right here. I have a photo of, on my Azores dark fig, of four different varieties I harvested. One is Azores Dark, one is LSU Champagne, and the other one is Smith. And the fourth one here is Violette de Bordeaux, which I don't have for sale. But what really strikes me is that how cool these all looked that day and how I got to eat all these in the same day. And how they all sort of have a similar, almost pyriform shape to them that really allows them to perform well in this climate. It really is, I think, a lot about the shape. And I read recently some work of Eisen, who was one of the leading experts on figs in the last 100 years. And he actually mentioned in one of his books that the shape does play a big part into its rain resistance and split resistance. And I always thought that because Celeste is such a great fig. And a lot of it, a lot of the rain resistance I feel has to do with its teardrop shape, which Violette de Bordeaux and Azores Dark and all these figs really sort of have that. Even Smith, when it's not as teardrop as the others, but they really do shine, and it just goes to show. It's just kind of weird, I think, is what I was getting at, is that most of the figs on this plate that I really enjoy, I just have for sale right now. I think that's just sort of ironic, I guess. Also, if you guys are really into this podcast and you want to support what I'm doing here, check us out on patreon.com/RossRaddi. I want to thank everybody out here for liking this one. Leave us a review. Subscribe if you haven't. If anybody didn't know out there, we are on iTunes, Spotify, all kinds of different podcasting platforms now. So thank you guys again. We'll see everybody next week for next week's episode of Fruit Talk. Take care, everybody.